Yes, much better now. And slightly tilt down. Yeah, good, good girl. Nice.
Lovely. Okay.
Okay.
So, good morning, everybody. My name is Amudan. I'm part
Vanakkam.
of Vanakkam. My name is Amudan. I'm part of Marpokkam. We are a small group who are into making films, screening films, organizing film festivals. And since the lockdown began, we've been organizing this weekend online film screenings. And this is a 28th film screening. And in between, we also did two, three film festivals. And like we did a film festival with artists, painters, cinema. We did our Madurai International Documentary and Film Festival. So we did few small two, three film festivals also. And first time we are showing two films. We call it twin films on agrarian crisis. So because when I was discussing with Nandan about the selecting the film for today, and we were found out that we can show the both the films, Cotton for My Shroud and Candles in the Wind. So I welcome Kavita Bal and Nandan Saxena, and I thank them for sharing their film. I thank them for agreeing to show their
Thank
film and
you.
taking part in the interaction. I also thank Mr. Vijayan, Ms. Vijayasanti, and other friends. Anita, I think Anita Ratnam has joined from Bangalore, I think, our old friend. So thank you all for joining. So the pattern is like to start it, I'll have a few questions and then others can join. Because we are a small group, all of us can ask questions and or comment. It can be kind of an intimate, personal kind of interaction. So it need not be a kind of a very formal, like seminar or a workshop. To
True.
start with, let me ask both of you. And you come from a journalist background. I understand you were a journalist for more than 2 to 3 decades, like 2 decades minimum, I understand. And how did you decide to become filmmakers, and what was the need for the shift, if you can start with anybody, both of you?
Yeah. So when we started, like I was with the Indian Express, and we were in the Northeast for 2 years. And those 2 years changed our lives. Because we had always been in ne Delhi, never traveled much. So we were like, Northeast was like we felt like we were fishes in a pond. And we were released into a sea. And it was shocking. It was like too much. It was overwhelming for us. Because frankly, most of us don't even know what are the seven sisters' names in India. And in our newspaper, in my newspaper, Indian Express, we used to sometimes have single column news coming from those seven states. So my level of exposure also was to that level only. It was not the era of internet, remember. There was no Google, there was nothing. And PTI was our main source. So when we reached Northeast, and when a lot of my stories started getting killed by our editors, because they didn't want to give so much of space to the Northeast. So at that time, we realized that we were being suffocated and that we needed to tell these stories, which were so-called coming from the margins. How to mainstream them? Because newspaper media will not give us space. And then we decided that we'll go full-fledged out, making documentaries on these subjects, which are close to our hearts, and these are stories which need to be told. That's how we started. Nandan, would you like to add?
देखो, एक चीज तो बहुत सुंदर
नॉट
तुमने बोली।
इंग्लिश इंग्लिश इंग्लिश
यस यस, आई
इंग्लिश
अंडरस्टैंड। आई सेल्फ सेल्फ करेक्ट, डोंट वरी। व्हेन एवर आई गो
थैंक
इनटू हिंदी और उर्दू और पंजाबी, आई विल रिपीट माय सेल्फ इन इंग्लिश आल्सो।
थैंक यू थैंक यू थैंक यू
सो आई एग्री दैट यस, वी वर फिशेस फ्रॉम अ स्मॉल पॉन्ड ऑफ दिल्ली। वी वर रिलीज्ड इनटू द ओशन ऑफ ब्रह्मपुत्रो, माइटी ओशन ऑफ ब्रह्मपुत्रो। बट देन we started challenging the concept of the mainstream. That was the my major shift that happened here, when we sort of freed ourselves from, being bound to Delhi, that we started challenging the concepts we were born with or we had imbibed while growing up. And I think that freed us, in a manner of speaking, that sort of broke the shackles of all the structured education that we call education in our country, which is basically trying to potty train you, like we potty train the dogs and cats, no? They are trying to potty train all of us into how to subjugate ourselves to the system. And that system has been hijacked very long ago by the elite, masquerading as our leaders and masquerading as the messiahs of the poor. And they have entrenched interests and they will sort of do anything to wear a mask. So democracy is a charade in our country. The entire system of populist schemes is just to give lollipops, using religion as, you know, some kind of a mass hypnotic system. So we started challenging our concepts and our precepts. That was something which the Northeast taught us. And then giving voice to the voiceless, oh, Mahatma Gandhi's talisman, you know, that the poorest of the poor, if you can reach out to the poorest of the poor, then you are sort of in a democratic system, and then you are actually, true humanity emerges when you reach out to the Antim Jan. So I think our training as journalists began with, you know, a very solid, you throw them into the deep end of the sea and then of the pool, and then you sort of see whether they can survive and they can swim. So as a journalist, I think, Amudan, we worked as 7 years, as journalists for 7 years, for various people. And the interesting thing that I'll share with you here is that Kavita Baidu, of course, was a very good writer and a very, very diligent worker. So she was prized by the Indian Express so much that her editor, H.K. Dua, when she went to resign, that I've got married and my husband is going to the Northeast, I can't stay here, Delhi mein, and do your pen pushing. I have to go. I have to travel. I have to learn. So he said, no, 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 we can't let you go. I'm sorry, baby. I'll give you a transfer. And he made her a special writer, special correspondent, and Northeast mein bhejke. He says, you file good stories and special stories from there. You're not going to do daily reporting. No chores for you. In contrast, I was a very, I know, very checkered kind of a career. I've been thrown out of all my jobs. I think I had 7. So between 6 months and 11 months is the tenure that I worked for one employer at a time, right? And that was not because I was a laggard at work or I was like late for anything apart from my classes when I used to attend my literature classes. I'll come to that story later. So in fact, I used to work more than I should have worked. Sometimes the work of 3 people and sometimes working 72 hours non-stop without sleeping. And Kavita spent her first Holi in our studio when we were working for Vinod Dua, sleeping on the floor of our small voiceover booth, because I was working on a documentary with my friends Vishakh Rathi and one more person was there. And I couldn't come home, and it was our first Holi, and she was there in the studio the night before, and she slept. So, aise aise karke to hum aage bade hain. So, 7 years, 7 jobs thrown out each time, for being too straightforward, for being sometimes critical of my employer, and in the meetings I used to tell them that, boss, please, this is not good. What you're doing is not correct. This is not journalism at all. So, of course, nobody likes a person like me, you know. I was always thrown out. And because I was thrown out, I could do whatever I did in my life. Otherwise, I am like such a steadfast person. One job, good job. I'm happy and I'm doing something meaningful for society or something and making a little bit of money. I'll stick to the person and the organization for life. So, God has been very kind that I got thrown out. So, what was your question?
You can't say nobody likes a person like you. Look, I have stuck. I have stuck to you for 27 years.
Yeah, ये तो कोई 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 जोड़ फेविकोल का होता है ना.
Very nice. Okay. So now, thank you for the wonderful introduction. Yeah. And coming back to these two films, like as you start making films, how did you decide to make films on agrarian crisis? Because it is not a very, you know, like a popular, you know, like a subject to make documentaries. And there are many, especially when the period in which you made films, there were films were making films on personal experiences, artistic expressions, you know. Even the issue-based documentaries were becoming outdated in that particular, if you remember those years. And deciding to do films on agriculture and farmers, if I am not right, when you made those two films, your films were one of the few films on agrarian crisis in India. And as P. Sainath says, even in journalism, agriculture, rural areas do not get any space. And yeah. Even in documentaries, it's similar. Mm-hmm. Agriculture and farming do not have, as far as I remember, there are few films on agriculture and farmers. Sometimes there are films on, experimental farming or organic farming or somebody who's doing passionate farming, something like that. There are very few films on, actual, quote unquote, actual farmers, the, community who are facing distress because of so many policy changes and all. So in that particular period, how did you decide to make these films? If you can start with the first film, Cotton for Myself.
Actually, these subjects, Amudan, we didn't choose them. They chose us. I say it with a lot of humility, and I don't say it with any ego, but we really don't choose our films. Our films choose us. And some people in our workshops have asked us this question. So how to train for a particular film, or how to prepare for a film like Cotton for My Shroud, for example, the first film that you mentioned. And I tell them that you can't prep for a film. You have to prep for life. You have to prep to become a human being. You have to prep to become an empathetic soul, a comrade to the farmers. Then and only then can you make a film like this. The films that you make, Amudan, it is not something that you have sort of, this is not a fad for you. This is not something that you've done that I'll have a better following and I'll have a better image if I do films like this. Something resonates within your soul with the issues that you pick up. So as filmmakers and as artists, we know that there is some calling, some deeper calling within, that you resonate with a particular issue and then you choose to work on it. Then you forget that. Then you also untrain your mind that somebody will give you money and then you will work, right? That is like the slot machine of the mother dairy. That's the example I can give. Usme sikka dalo, you put a coin and usme doodh aayega, right? And do sikka dalo, 1 liter. 4 coins, 2 liters. Now, what are we doing? We are waiting for somebody to pay us to become human beings. Tomorrow, I'll stop breathing because nobody has paid me for this day, boss. I'll stop breathing. This is a lot of work. I can't do all this. No. So same way, we understood that we don't have to wait for things to happen, for somebody to assign a job and somebody to pay us for a project. If we are so concerned about our farmers, and Sainath was writing such brilliant articles and such great detail that we found it very difficult to duck that. Really, one had to duck the newspaper because it was so depressing and it was so moving in the details that he went into. And so how long can you ignore something like that, which is happening in our country? How long? And the media was underplaying it. Apart from Hindu, other papers were actually not concentrating on that. It was like page 7 or some inside page, 2-column, 1-column news.
Farmers. And you know, those were the days when filmmakers like us used to look for story ideas in the newspapers. Because if you remember that in those days, we didn't have any online newspapers or magazines or Google search. So we were totally dependent in a way on our networks and on the newspapers. And Hindu was the only newspaper who was kind of constantly posting about farmer suicides. And after a point, as Nandan very rightly said, it became impossible to ignore. And then we thought, let's go and find out. Because, and then I started making calls, and I have to thank my journalistic, you know, training for that. And I could just make inroads into newspapers, get the names of the correspondents, talk to them over phone and ask them. This is how we reached Vidarbh Jan Andolan Samiti in Nagpur. And they were the only NGO who were working with the farmers. They had maintained what we called a farmer suicide register, where they were actually recording every suicide that was happening in Maharashtra in every village. So me and Nandan, we went down to Nagpur and met Kishore Tiwari. And that's how this film started. And after meeting him, we were very sure that we wanted to do this film. And he was very surprised that two people have come all the way from Delhi just to talk to him, to understand what was happening on ground. But then we started on this journey, yeah.
And when we started on the journey, there was no template. Kishore Tiwari asked us, when are you going back? We said, no, we've come without a return ticket. He was surprised. He said, BBC wale aate hain, they come for a day and they go back. Doordarshan wale aate hain, they spend few hours and go back. They just want a few shots and a few bites. I said, no, we are not into news gathering. We want to make a film out of this. So he said, okay. And then we stuck it out. We went in the summers when the sowing period is there. That is one spurt of farmer suicides. And then we went again towards winters when they pluck the cotton and they take the cotton produced to the mandis, to the APMC. And then we saw the entire gamut of issues that come into play like a story. And we picked up a few characters, and through the set of characters, we chose to tell this very moving story. And there were moments, and there were many moments where sort of we were face to face with such grim tragedy that Kavita was totally in tears and shattered, and I had to keep the camera rolling. So I didn't have the luxury to sort of stop or to think about it. I was just a vessel, you know. I was just a medium. Kavita was just a medium. We didn't ever think that, okay, we are doing something very great or something. And in fact, we got into such a big depression after filming that and starting to edit, because you could hear all those, you know, women wailing in the night when you sit and edit in your basement studio and everything comes back to you with a force. So after some time, I got into a very bad situation, and for 4 years, we did not edit our material for 4 long years. After starting to edit and stuff, we could not continue, and it was shattering. And Kishore Bhai Tiwari called us, a couple of other people, Mohan Jadhav, he was a great help at Nagpur, he called us. And they actually gave up on us. They thought that we've got some good money from Sharad Pawar and not less than a crore. And we are not going to edit our film ever. So that's what they told me on my face when they actually watched the film. And then it sort of struck me that these people have shared the darkest chapters of their lives with us. And they have placed their trust in us, whom they did not know. And the people who have lost their sons, and people who have lost their fathers, daughters who have lost their fathers. how can I sort of keep all that sorrow on my tapes forever and let it be? My studio cannot become the graveyard of those stories. And we have to give it life. Instead of digging a graveyard, I thought that, okay, let us create a fertile field. Let us drop these seeds, the seeds of those sorrowful stories. And when they germinate, may they become, you know, mighty bargad and mighty neem. And they will shelter a lot of troubled souls and a lot of people who are giving up hope. And they will become beacons that know, stand strong, stand tall. Things will change. Now today the farmers are laying a siege at the borders, at the citadel of Delhi, no? Shaking up the mighty, the high and mighty. So things will change. The revolution is possible. It has just morphed into something else. We don't recognize things when they are, you know, the groundswell is building. Only when the tsunami becomes so strong and it hits you and breaks the citadel of Delhi, then we understand that, okay, yes, there was something, there was an undercurrent. People wake up then. Okay. So slowly we edited the film and...
No, I mean, just hold on. I will go back to, I wanted to rewind to the shooting portion.
Okay.
I just want you to share, like, of course, you had your preparation, you had your research, everything. But when you started filming or when you are doing the planning for the filming and the process of filming, what kind of an experience you faced? What happened, you know, as a filmmaker, as a journalist, as a concerned citizen of this country? What all you witnessed and what happened inside you? What did you learn? What did you develop? The idea of farming, of the rural drive, the villagers, the labor, the physical labor, the respect for that. What all happened? And if you can explain to us.
Yeah, so first of all, we have to thank Vidarbh Chan Andolan Samiti, because once they understood that there were these two people, you know, who had come to record and they were very serious about their intent, then they went all out. They did a lot of hand-holding. They would take us to villages and there, like, of course, we were on our own, and they would take us to families where suicides had happened. And Marathi is one language which you can, if you've read, say, Sanskrit at college, school level, you can still get most of it. But they did a lot of hand-holding, translated things for us. And it was utterly shocking, because the suicides were taking place. The people who were taking their own lives belonged to the lowest strata of society. They were marginal farmers, farmers who didn't really have much, and their land was their only source of livelihood. That one thing became very clear to us. Second, there was a further classification that most of these farmers were from Aboriginal communities. So they were further marginalized. And then we also understood that they were a lot dependent on the agriculture department for selection of their seed, for guidance. And the government was constantly pushing them towards BT cotton. So they were kind of the poorest of the poor were actually being kind of led to a genocide. It was like that. This is what we understood. They were being pushed into an agriculture which was totally unsustainable. When they were dealing with their own seed, the desi seed, it was bad enough even then because they could not survive. But at least they knew whether the seed will work or not. They knew what kind of fertilizer and pesticide would go on top. They didn't have to buy everything. Now with this BT cotton thing, they were buying even the seed. And then the seed needed special fertilizers. Then it needed more expensive pesticides to save it from bollworm, which it didn't ultimately. BT cotton is a big failure. It has been proven. But then it has taken a big toll, and we understood that these people had nowhere to go. And we also understood what the yoke of patriarchy does. Most of the times, the women, the father, didn't even know the kind of loans their sons had taken. They had no clue. It was only after they took, the sons went away, and the people who had given credit started lining up on their doors. The family understood the kind of pressure their son was under. So it was a big debt trap. And this was obviously very depressing, very shocking. And then so many suicides. I mean, 2012, I think, was one of the worst years for farmer suicides. While we were filming, we would get suddenly a call that somebody has taken his life, and we would just rush. And as you can see in the film, the scene that was happening at their houses, people are totally clueless. So how can we let not, how can we just not place accountability here? Where is the accountability in this system? This is what we felt. There was no accountability in this country at all.
And that how did it affect you, Kavita?
How would it affect any human being?
Good question.
The depression that you are talking about, it was on the ground also. I mean, we were like literally dreading, we were living with the dread. Here we were trying to make a film on farmer suicides, and we didn't want any suicides to happen. We would dread that we shouldn't get a call telling us that a suicide has happened. We didn't want to see any more dead bodies. We could not take the wailing of the woman. Women, it was very distressing. The kind of emptiness, shock on the faces of the children as they sit beside their father's dead body. It was like too much.
Camera.
Yeah. Nandan, do you like to add?
Also, you can continue. Also, yeah. on the, of course, your personal experience. Also, your understanding about agriculture, the understanding of agro economy, rural life, you know. And what did you also find? Like as Kavita mentioned about the debt trap, or the way government was pushing them to use BT cotton. Besides, what did you learn about agriculture per se, you know, and how did you come to a conclusion that, you know, how did you question yourself, your own understanding of agriculture?
Okay. So, being a city bred, you know, person, my understanding of agriculture came from the textbooks. They talk to you about the Green Revolution in very flowery terms, and they sort of try to sell you the idea of India that is shining. Before the image was coined, before the slogan was coined, the textbooks were actually propagating an India shining image, talking to us about the Green Revolution in Punjab and Haryana and everything in very flowery terms. So when we actually went to the ground and we thought that, okay, let us explore for ourselves without any rose-tinted glasses, without the glasses that the system has given us, without all the doctoring that has gone into our structuring our thought. And then without all those things preconditioning our understanding of what is happening, we saw a very different India. We saw an India where the farmers, who are the mainstays of our economy forever, boss, we are a proper agrarian country. Agrarian economy is a, you know, sort of diminishing of the identity of our country. We are an agrarian nation because we are not a nation of parasites. Only a true farmer is a person who can hold himself aloft and say that, okay, I grow what I eat and I feed you. The rest of us are parasites. So a nation of agriculturists, actually not agriculturists, a nation of farmers, there's a difference. There's a very minute difference between agriculture and farming. Agriculture is an industrial process. Farming is not. Farming is a way of life. Farming is what we do because it's in our genetic material. It's in our sanskara. It is something that we sort of have imbibed from our forefathers. It is not something which we take as a profession because we have to earn money. No. So this is a very important distinction between farming and agriculture. We are a nation of farmers. Agricultural economy is an apabhrancha. That is a sort of vulgarization of the thought of India. And both Congress and BJP are complicit in this. They have reduced us to an industrialized thinking process, boss, where everybody is a cog in a machine. No, we are not cogs in a machine. Give us a break, boss. We are human beings and we are sort of in a system which is very strange, but organically and intrinsically, we are very different kind of a society. We were a different nation once upon a time. Now, it is indistinguishable from the West. We are as greedy or as lazy and as sort of work shirking a people as anywhere else. We are more corrupt than most people in the world. What are we talking? What India are we talking? What nationalism are we talking? We have taught ourselves to become the lowest of the, rung. Talk of the Human Development Index or talk of anything, GDP or whatever. We are at the bottom. We are sometimes faring very badly, worse than the nations that we don't even talk of, don't even know the spellings of, worse than those nations. So when I went to the ground, Amudhan, to answer your question briefly, I saw that the farmers have been reduced to beggars by this coterie of vested interests, both in Congress and the BJP. They are the same people with this different mask. One has a mask of centrism and the other one has a mask of Dakshin Panth, but they are the same people. It's not different at all. And they are blood-sucking people. Yeah, what are you talking? They are not leaders or whatever. They are joke hota na, joke chipak jata, the leech. So they are leeches on the body politic. And they are sucking us dry day after day without us knowing. So the farmer does a very simple thing when the leech attaches. He rubs a little bit of salt and the leech is gone. So we saw that some farmers have started waking up to the idea of going back to their organic agriculture. But the rest of them are too sold out on this false god of progressive farming, which the government of India, the GOI, and their agriculture department and the extension department of the agriculture ministry are feeding them, selling them, forcing them, coercing them. And the artiyas, the people who are selling the pesticides, and they're also giving the loans because the rural banking infrastructure has been systematically dismantled since 1955. Very systematically, they have destroyed their own rural banking infrastructure so that the farmers are in a perpetual state of depression and distress, and they fall into their traps and their specious reasoning very easily. So what we found was that at the ground, the farmers have become beggars. They do not have their self-respect and self-esteem anymore. They don't trust their own judgment, which has been organically evolving over millennia of farming. They know what soil will produce what crop in what season, how much of watering, how much of urvarak, the fertilizer, and that is desi urvarak, desi fertilizer, not the chemicals. And what kind of tilling machinery do they use? Which soil requires a hoe, which is this much, and which requires this much? they were so sort of knowledgeable. And when the Tatas took over after our so-called independence, everything became, okay, boss, Tata will make steel and Tata will also produce implements. Why did Tata have to produce farming implements? Let them produce the steel, no problem, no issues. Let the ironsmiths in each village or each taluka decide that, okay, we'll get our steel from Tata now, but let us make the implements because we know our dharti, our mother earth, it requires this much of a blade or this much of a blade or it requires this much of a blade. So that Tata didn't know. It standardized everything, and that standardization is actually the bastardization of all speciality. And they sort of reduced our agricultural scientists, our farmers. They were agricultural scientists in their own right. They had more knowledge than most scientists that sit in the ICAR today. What do we know about that? What do we know of the practices? We don't. And all that was sort of let go of. Those people were discredited. Those people had to live a life of penury. They couldn't earn enough to save their own skin, to feed their own children, to marry their daughters. So farming became a practice of sort of going downhill. It was not a remunerative job anymore. And even if we had the right soil, we had the right samskara, and our farmers thought that the Mother Earth, it is their sacred duty to till the Mother Earth, and to produce food is a sort of sacred responsibility. And they were very highly respected and valued as members of a society. All that changed, boss. The non-farm agriculture also changed. And when the government started dictating to them, when the scientists started usurping their position and saying that, oh, you are backward people. What are you doing with all this gober? All bullshit. You've got to go into pesticides and fertilizers that we'll package for you and send you. Then you are progressive farmers. Otherwise, what backward farmers are you? So when I observed all that and sort of it pained me that, okay, this is a systemic rot. This is not, we can't just blame one actor in this. Yes, the government has been the sutradhar of all this destroying of the true India. Successive governments have destroyed my mother nation. They have killed the spirit of India. But what have people like us been doing? Why are we sleeping? Why is the civil society sort of quiet? Why is the civil society so unperturbed? It is not bothered about what is happening. Why can't we bloody join the dots someday? Are we also slot machines?
I just want to intervene here.
Yeah, sure.
I also want to ask, Kavita mentioned about small farmers. She mentioned about small farmers. She mentioned about marginalized sections. She mentioned about tribals. If you can explain the role of small farmers, explain the role of tribals, explain the role of marginalized. If you mean tribe Dalits, so caste angle to the whole agriculture crisis.
Yeah, what we also felt was say what I would call the lack of unity amongst the farmers community also. Because a lot of people who had large land holdings, who had access to water, and those who could, you know, plant those water sprinklers on their lands, they could still bear the losses. Who had access to big mandis, who could pay hefty commissions to the artiyas, they could still survive the crisis in agriculture. But the small and marginal farmers, they could not. And they had actually no voice. There were no farmers' bodies who were talking about the distress of the poor and marginalized farmers at all. So they actually had nowhere to go. This is what we felt. The farmers' leaders also, they came from positions of affluence. And they were mostly big landowners themselves. So they perhaps could not understand. There was no representation. There was a total lack of, there still is. I'm saying was because my observations come from when I was filming the film. But there still is, this, it's the same thing. For instance, we also felt a hugely marginalized section in this entire agriculture was are the women. Because they are the ones who till the land and who do a lot of work that men will not do in the fields. Yet they could, they are not the official land owners ever. I mean, their names are never in the records. So this was one thing we felt. And this is how Amudhan, as you were asking, how the ideas came about. The Candles in the Wind was born out of cotton for my shroud, if I may say so. Because when we were filming cotton, we felt that, which was important at that point in time, the narrative of the film was a lot about the policy decision of introducing BT cotton and how it totally upset the apple cart and how it became the cause of suicide among the cotton farmers in India. So our focus was totally in on that narrative because we wanted to bring it out strongly. So it became an investigative piece into how BT cotton had failed. It was a wrong policy decision. But there was a big section, the women, who were not represented well in the film. And that rankled in our hearts. Because after the man goes away, the loans don't go away. And the brunt of all of it falls on the women of the house. And then we wanted to do another film. It would have been very easy for us to go back to Vidarbha, because that's where all our case studies were. We knew the farmers, we knew the women. It would have been very easy. But then when we started researching, we understood that the cotton farmer suicides have found a new home. And that's Punjab, the bread bowl of India, supposedly one of the most prosperous states in India. And then so we based Candles in the Wind, the farmer's widow story, in Punjab. So we found that they had no land to their names, yet they were supposed to repay all the loans. They were supposed to take care of young children, the aging parents, the fields which had been totally destroyed by overuse of fertilizer due to contract farming. Their stories need to be told. And this is how Candles in the Wind then was set in Punjab. Yeah. Have I answered your question, Amudhan? Nandan, would you like to add?
Yeah, I think to answer the particular question about the Dalit participation and the Adivasi participation, we prefer to call them Adivasis because that gives them the respect that is due to them because they are the original dwellers of the land. They are the original inhabitants. By calling them tribals, which is what the British started doing, or the anthropologists started doing, treating them as specimens, you know, to be studied under a microscope in a laboratory. What we are doing is sort of taking away their identity and their ownership of the land that they call their mother and that they have tilled over generations. They don't have any papers because, boss, if I own the shirt, I don't need any papers. It's on my chest, you know. I'm wearing it. If I have this gamosa, which is what I got from the Northeast as a token of their love for us, and I have sort of chosen to carry it on my skin ever since. So this is, I'm not going to sort of give a certificate that we got so much of love from the Northeast. This is my certificate, what? This is my proof. I don't have to sort of make a slogan out of it. Same way, the Adivasis don't have papers. You don't have papers to your own children. It's a question of trust. So it's a question of a lot of things like friendship, like love. There are no papers. There's no legal guarantee. It's a question of bonding. It's a question of empathy. It's a question of love. Now, these things, no system understands. And no system wants to understand. Because these things are beyond the ken of these mere mortals who are masquerading as our leaders and our administrators. Because these people are machines of the worst order, boss. These are machines that malfunction. Coming back to Kavita is reminding me, I have to come back to the Dalit question. So these Adivasis and the Dalit people were the mainstays of our village economy for a very long time. See, the upper castes don't want to work, no. The Brahmins, the Savarna Brahmins, in most cases, when they are well off, do not want to work as labor. In cases where we have seen that these people are also poor, so it's a question of poverty, it's a question of economic resources, then they are open to even pulling a rickshaw. They are not very happy doing it, but they are going to do it. But in the village, the systems were vitiated long time ago. And these Savarna people have been occupying positions of power and sort of getting paid or getting a lot of obeisance from the rest of the people, while the rest of the people have been doing a majority of the work. And the Adivasis in Vidarbha are a sizable community who have been the mainstays of a lot of places where the black soil is very fertile and they have produced very good crops, very good cotton, also very good tuar. A lot of dalhan and tilhan used to come from our fields, which is basically pulses and grams and oil seeds. And today, with all our progress and all our sort of opening up and whatever, we are importing pulses and grams and oil seeds from countries outside, from Malaysia and from other places and from Africa. What a travesty. What a bloody travesty. We were exporters of oil seeds as well as grams and pulses. Now, what has gone wrong with our system? What has gone wrong with our agriculture? That somehow, from net exporters and sort of producers of great value, we have been reduced to people who cannot even feed our own people. We have to import stuff. Now we are looking at Adani and Ambani to import food and to grow food somewhere else because they can do it with all kinds of chemicals and pesticides without environmentalists in our country waking up. So what are we doing? So that's what we saw, Amudhan, in the villages at Vidarbha. So farming is in a very bad shape, in a disarray, but it is not just the government and their horrible policies. It's also people like us who have not sort of risen up in revolt. We don't understand that the farmer is the annadata, no. The farmer feeds us and the farmer clothes us. And if the farmer dies, if the farmer is gone, if the farmer's son and the daughter are not going to become farmers, then we are going to be a nation of very poor people. We'll have to depend on Adanis and Ambanis to import everything for us.
Kavita. Okay. Thank you. So I just, I'll stop here. I'll invite others to give their comments or ask questions. So I'll take the privilege of inviting our friends. Can I invite Mr. Vijayan to give his comments or questions? Mr. Vijayan?
Yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes. I watched the two documentaries. It has been a spine-chilling experience. And frankly, without any exaggeration, I can say it was a traumatic experience and quite relevant even to this day. So in that way, you have been walking ahead of the times, especially when the pathetic plight of the farmers have been accentuated far, far than what it was. Instead of finding some solace or mitigation in their condition, their situation has been deteriorating and the suicide rate is going on unabated. And but the sad part is nobody is bothered nor any, there is no redressal whatsoever.
True.
Despite all this. And see, the farm, the government, they think that, especially in a country like India, we know that it's the cornerstone of our nation is agriculture. Because the majority, at least 70 to 80% is dependent on agriculture for their survival, for the nation's, development. But they think, no, it's the industries. And the because of, with a huge population, it's the agriculture that can absorb and mitigate the sufferings of the people by gainfully employing them. Yes, we do say that it's the vagaries of the monsoon that is the root cause of the decadence of agriculture. No, it's not only that. In that field, we have been able to provide some relief by building canals, connectivity, and all that. So those issues have been taken care of, to at least to a limited extent. But the other serious problems of like how to provide some succor to them in the that debt part. We don't have any qualms in writing of the NPAs into crores. But when it comes to these petty amounts, nobody is bothered. They are very strict. The law comes with its might and knocks at the doors of these poor farmers. And just see how so many lives have been destroyed. Mm. No concern. Nobody is bothered.
Mm.
And another thing is that, again, the basic, like seed. Seed is a crucial thing.
Mm.
And it is there, the government has very cunningly, you can say within quotes, intervened and spoiled. Because traditionally, the farmers used to use the same seeds and they used to keep apart some seeds for the next for planting for the next season, but now no, you have to buy the seeds from the market, and there is no guarantee, no about the quality of it, about its productivity, about its fertility, and for which you had to depend upon these fertilizers and chemicals, which in other way spoils the entire nature of the soil. It damages it for no return. You're in a situation where there is no return. Like the impact of the moneylenders. Right from our school days, we used to study the blood-sucking so-called moneylenders. But they are still, their grip is still becoming more and more powerful. There's nothing happening.
True.
As has been mentioned, it's not a suicide. It is really genocide. The government, it's pure genocide. But I'm surprised to know how these world bodies, UN or human rights organizations, they are also not being able to effectively intervene to put a stop to this nonsense. It has been going on and on.
When we went to London, Mr. Vijayan, we were invited for the World Investigative Film Week. With this film, Cotton for My Shroud, as the headline film. Mane, this was their main film for the festival. And when we went there, they said that, okay, we want to sort of have Monsanto also on the panel. And we are inviting very important scientists and NGOs of UK. And we would like to have a discussion. I said, yes, brilliant. Let's have a discussion. So, of course, Monsanto ran away from the discussion. They didn't come. And the media asked us a very important question. They said, this is a genocide as the film has so amply stated and demonstrated that this is a genocide because, see, 10 farmers, they kill themselves, suicide. Okay. 100 farmers, suicide. No problem. Now, the bloody issue is, if 3 lakh farmers have killed themselves according to the Sarkar, according to the government, over the last 16 years or 17 years, and this is coming from the National Crime Records Bureau, their information says 3 lakh farmers have committed suicide. Now, what else is a genocide? So you don't have the killing fields of Hitler, where you sort of really gas your victims. You are slowly killing your farmers. It is the same bloody thing. It's more painful. And you are destroying the backbone of your nation. You are going to destroy the food security of your nation if you sort of slowly kill your farmers. So this is what the government is doing. This is what we found very painful. And as Kavita mentioned, it is very painful that our civil society is not waking up to what is happening in their country and how badly it will impact their own lives. Mm. But that's very painful for us.
Thank you, Nandan. Thank you, Mr.
Yes, and just one more observation.
Yes. And quickly.
See, please. About the green, much touted green revolution, has there been any meaningful studies conducted on the efficacy or the effects, adverse or maybe favorable effects of this green revolution? I think it's time that we took an impartial view and a meaningful study on the impact of this green revolution. And still we are priding ourselves that the second green revolution is on the way and all that. Maybe your thoughts on that.
Vandana Shiva's organization has done some studies mm-hmm. on the failure of the green revolution. Some studies have also been conducted by TIS, some of the TIS scholars. Mm-hmm. But then, I think we definite Candles in the Wind is actually one of the films that shows the dark side of the green revolution only. Because they are the farmers who were led into this trap of indebtedness. They show that how the green revolution has failed, even in states like Punjab, which have access to water, which have free electricity. And still, there are suicides happening there. So this is actually, but then in this film, you very rightly say that we need another document which clearly exposes the failure. Because here we wanted to focus on the human face of this failure in the shape of these women, you know, how they have suffered and they are suffering. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
And about the subsidy issue, a lot of people, they say you're giving out doles as freebies. No, it's subsidies are the critical thing which are very crucial for their sustenance.
Yeah.
So, it's made out that it is as if you are just wasting money on by providing subsidies.
Yeah.
Actually, Vijayan, it's a deeper rot because subsidy is just a game that they are playing because they want to show themselves as the data and the other person as the bhikari. If they correct the skews that they have built into the system of agriculture by raising the input costs inexorably and by reducing the dam that the person should get after spending so much of time and effort in raising a crop, if he gets remunerative prices, which takes care of all his expense and all his livelihood issues, then there is no problem. Then the subsidy will not be required. But they don't want to correct all those things because they want corporate farming to come over and take away the land and take away everything from the farmer and reduce us to mere pawns in the bloody game and reduce the farmers and by obliterating the small farmer totally. They want the Western model where machines and one farmer will till thousands of hectares of land. We don't want that. We want our farmers to be alive and kicking, boss. So that skew, the government does not want to correct. That is why the subsidies are their stopgap arrangement, which make them feel good and get them votes. Come on, get the bloody field corrected. No, इशू खत्म हो जाएगा.
थैंक यू रंजन.
थैंक यू थैंक यू.
लेट मी इनवाइट विजय शांति. विजय शांति.
First of all, thanks to both the filmmakers for bringing this film to us. So I think when all of you were discussing Sainath's work, every now and then it kind of reminded me how when I was watching the film, for me also it reminded me his works a lot. So set of questions that I have for both of you. One, first of all, I like the film for bringing in different kinds of angles to it. One, talking about the economic aspect of it and the cause and effect, that we are trying to bring in here. And then how genetics as a study sort of has evolved as a discipline also. But then what does it do to farming as such? Because genetics is one of the growing subjects in colleges and in universities. How is that discipline being addressed? For example, when we sit in science classes, we do not talk about the kind of problems that nuclear power plants may have. Though we talk about it, maybe passing by, it just gets referred and then we go on with the positives of it. Similarly, what should genetics as a discipline should be teaching in these classes is something that I'm thinking of, because I think there is a huge information that I could find in this particular documentary. My question is, both of you were journalists and then you did documentary. Amudan sir asked that question. I've also watched another film made by Ramdas sir, who also was a journalist. And I see there is a kind of long form tone that comes in your structure of a documentary as well. So in that sense, documentary and long form, do you think it are too different in its structures? Or do they complement each other? If in case there are differences, what are the differences? And is it effective when it transforms itself into a documentary? This is the first question, if you could respond to it.
There are two questions actually in this question also. So I have even forgotten about the first half. Let me come to the second half, what you're saying about the long form. Our storytelling comes from a position of sort of being the witnesses or chroniclers or historians of our times. So if we can tell it effectively and we can capture some of the drama which is inherent in the real lives of our such vibrant characters that we have come across, then it is God's grace. But we are primarily bearing witness to what is unfolding around us. And we are bringing home very distressing moments. What Vijayan was also saying, that he really got traumatized watching the films. So I'm sorry that we do it to all of you, but we are bringing very painful truths up close and showing the mirror to a lot of people who have not gone out to the village ever, who have not been to such places, who have not met such widows or such orphans. They will not understand what the Green Revolution truly is till the time you share the charpai of that old woman who is sitting and sobbing about her son who has committed suicide and telling you the story of his father and her husband who had also committed suicide. So in Punjab, we found many families where there have been multiple suicides in the same family. 3 suicides in the same family. Can you believe it? So it is a very heartbreaking kind of a situation that we have witnessed. And when we witness something like that, so capturing it in a 10-minute does not do justice. And we are actually not feeding to that market which wants MTV style quickies, or which we wants Arnab Goswami style kangaroo court situation. The nation wants to know, and the nation wants to know right now because I am live. So that is Man Ki Baat of Arnab Goswami. So we are not pandering to those people at all. if they like the films, if they watch the films, if they have the bloody time, good for them. But that's not my audience. Our audience is comprised of people and students of life and literature and film and agrarian policies, anybody who is open and anybody who understands what it is to be human and what it takes to engage with another human, to have empathy, to have pride in our own heritage, and to understand that if there are problems, then all of them cannot be sort of handled by some administration, some government. No. We have the agency. The farmers have the agency. The civil society has agency. We can't give up our agency totally to this sarkar. What sarkar, boss? They are our servants. We have elected them to just run the system. The system has been created to feed the poorest of the poor. That they are not bloody doing. They are bad people, bad workers. I would have sacked them and thrown them into a sort of, Kavita.
Vijaya, I also feel that it is the subject of the film that decides the form of the film. For instance, if you're dealing with the policy issue, say the BT cotton issue. So once you go to the ground, like for a documentary filmmaker, it's like you have to pick up your case studies and understand how best to tell it. So some filmmakers, they just stick to one case study to have the coherence in the film. And they just take his or her story from beginning to end in a narrative arc. And then they kind of see how far it will go, whether it's a long form or not. But it is very challenging when you are dealing with, say, the failure of BT cotton, India's first commercially grown BT cotton crop. How can you effectively say it? So we obviously, as any filmmaker would do, you pick up your case studies. But in this case, since the suicides were happening when we were there, and we did not know what we will get the next day. So as filmmakers, a lot of our footage came, every day we had new footage which we weren't expecting, stories that suddenly started going haywire, new stories that started coming up, which had never planned for. So ultimately we landed up with a lot of footage. And it became hugely challenging for us to say a coherent story, because ultimately every film is a story. We are trying to tell somebody's story to you. And I want you to stick to me from beginning till the end. I don't want that after 10 minutes you say, no, this is too boring. I can't take it anymore. This has too much of trauma for me. So it also has to be palatable in a way. So it was hugely challenging to make cotton from a shroud. But yes, I think we thought that the long form was best suited to it. And this is how we went.
Oh, sorry. There are two more things. I'm so sorry. I'm taking
one more thing. Please. One more small bit. We were sort of very happy that nobody has put any money into our slot machine. So we were not tailoring our content to a channel which had a slot of 44 minutes, 48 minutes, 51 minutes, 52 minutes, no, or 13 minutes. We were our own free birds. We could take, as Kavita in her chaste Urdu, she says, panchiyon ke par nahi gine jate, unki parwaaz dekhi jati hai. So we were fortunate that we could observe the bird in its flight and not sort of be constrained to start counting its feathers, whether we could or we could not. So we were not constrained by anybody putting a coin into the slot machine. We said, let the stories take their own shape. We will not prejudge. We will not go with, as documentarians, most of us allow the script to emerge from what we are doing. The stories tell their own story. The characters tell their own story. And the meta-narrative is as important to us as the small stories that become part of our film. Yeah.
Yeah, Shweta, you were saying.
Just one more thing that I want to just share. It was also interesting to see the whole, I wouldn't say autoethnographical point, but you start off with the I narrative, with the first film that I watched, right? It started off with your journey. And even in the discussion, you started off with the I journey. And both as a journalist and as a documentary filmmaker, more often than not, a pattern that we see is we are told that we have to detach ourselves from our stories. We have to, keep our personal spaces and things like that. But also there are other kind of filmmakers who do bring in the personal narrative because the personal becomes also political in some way. So that's something that I found it interesting, both in the discussion and also in the film that I watched. Then one more thing that I did find interesting is the discussion between the woman and that politician, where she is demanding government job from her son, and she continues to demand that. I don't know if it was for the screen. See, she seems like she would have done even off the screen, so I don't know how did that happen. Was it like I don't know how did that
it was actually very interesting, because we wanted, you are very right, she would have done it in any case, but we wanted it to happen on the camera. So we kind of manipulated it a bit, because when the Palak Mantri, the Guardian Minister, agreed to give us his interview, so he was, after he was almost through, we asked her to come in and enter the frame.
What I did, Kavita, you must add, what we did was we gave him a lapel mic. So he was wired to my camera, tethered to my camera. He couldn't have run away. And we had a boom operator holding a big boom onto him. And I had a frame, and which was rolling. The camera was rolling. So if he chose to run away, that would have been on camera. And in between, Kavita got the woman inside after the interview was almost through with the Palak Mantri, where we had allowed him to say whatever he wanted to say without puncturing his balloon too much, so that he's not sort of offended or whatever. We let him say what he was saying. And in that also, he exposed his own party and his own thought so badly that it was such a joy to film that. It was actually, I was gleeful. I was very, very difficult to hide my smile and my grin. So I had a kala kapla on top of my head and my camera to get the focus right, and also to hide my grin. Then we got this lady in, Kavita brought her in, while I was into my job. Kavita, back to you.
Yeah, so he couldn't escape, because he knew the camera was rolling. And she came and just blasted him right, left and center. This is what he deserved. So otherwise, but then we also realized that though we feel that she would have talked to him in any case, but these guys are totally inaccessible.
Yeah.
He was sitting with his own guys in one corner. And because we had the camera and we were pushy and we were a bit aggressive there, which was the need to be. Otherwise, he wouldn't have talked to us. And so we could at least give him, she could give him a piece of her mind. So that way, the camera, what we call, becomes the agent of provocation. So
agent
this is what,
provocateur.
Yeah, this is what happened in this case.
But before this sequence, Kavita, do you remember that scene when the Palak Mantri is sitting like a demigod or a Raja? With his own Godi media, right?
Yeah.
And those Godi media were like buttering him right, left and center. And this poor woman was standing there and her husband was standing there and they were not even talking to her properly.
No, for them, it is business as usual. For them, it is business as
usual.
And
even my camera got pushed around. See, I was the only non-Marathi speaking person in that gathering. And they saw us and they understood this is a madam and a sir from Delhi. Apne aapko pata nahi kya samajhte hain. So I got elbowed quite a bit. I was elbowed quite a bit by the photographers and the cinematographers there, because they understood that we don't know what these people are doing and let us sort of ruin their frame, even if it doesn't matter to us. So Then we took the Palak Mantri then and told him that it's too noisy here. Can we have a small bite outside? Because this is going to be a long documentary.
Yeah. Amadan, you want to say something?
Thank you. That's all. Yes. So can I invite Anita Ratnam?
Yes, please.
Amita, your questions, comments?
Let me just say thank you for these films and for sharing your own journeys of making these films. And
thank you
that you've been able to say so powerfully. These are very, very important, in a way, stories. They're not stories, they're lives and deaths. And I think I would like to just ask you all to comment on how you see the link between distress. I think there's much more distress than the suicides. For every suicide, there are migrations, there are almost suicides, there are distress sales, there are exits, and the vast armies of people that we have now in the cities who are trying to supplement farm income with other forms of livelihood. Farmers are trying very hard to just stay afloat and not, take this very drastic and terrible step of killing oneself. And I think today what we are seeing is this, that there's this need to somehow get a lot of people out of farming. I think Chidambaram himself has said that he sees progress as when people will be farming. You create this huge army of unskilled labor who will be available to drive taxis and to build homes and, you know, do silly jobs, etc. So I see a much deeper paradigm issue behind stories of sort of changing the structure of our farming itself and creating a new kind of a working class that can be easily exploited and pushed and pulled. How do you see the link between these stories and the larger narrative that's unfolding before us today, and which came out very starkly during the lockdown? Where are all these people coming from? What have they gone back to? Frightening.
Actually, this is what my fear as a citizen is, that we have got too used to, you know, addressing everything in a piecemeal. For instance, right now, the farmers who are protesting these farm laws, and they have literally held Delhi under a siege. But the point is that there are many, many other issues in the agriculture sector which need to be taken care of. It's not that the entire agriculture of India is hinging on these three farm laws. When you go to the village, you understand that how people who even are farmers, who are growing their own food, don't have enough food in their homes to feed their children. This is how the deep distress is. This is how deeply it affects them. They'll rather sell their produce all to the Aartiya and buy a little from the market for their own families. This is the situation of the small and the marginal farmers today. And how they are totally dependent on the Aartiyas. Yet, because there are nobody else giving them credit, they don't even want the Aartiya to go. So it is very easy for us to sit here and say the Aartiyas are bad. But once you go into a village, you understand that Aartiya has totally gripped the communities under the Aartiya's grip, but the point is they can't even do without the Aartiya. The moneylender.
Moneylender, yeah.
Mm-hmm. The moneylender, they can't do without the moneylender, because at night if somebody falls ill and they have to take them to the nearest hospital, which is 50 kilometers away, they'll go to the Aartiya and say, give me 2,000 rupees. So reforms are needed at each and every place. The women who don't even get, who work harder than men, they don't even get half the wages of what the men are getting.
Some states, they are not even called farmers, you know.
The widow pension is 150 rupees. In some states, it's 500 rupees a month. Can even one person survive in 500 rupees? And do you expect that she'll take care of her entire family in 500 rupees? So the kind of reforms, then there are sharp wedges, divides between the money lenders, money landowners, and the non-landowners, the laborers, which come from Dalit sections in the society. And then the way industrialization has been done in agriculture, a number of these Dalit communities were surviving because they were picking up grain, they were cleaning the grain, they were cleaning the fields after one crop and another. Everything is being done by machines now. What happened to their livelihoods? How will they survive? So a lot of reform is required now because of these three farm laws. What I fear as a citizen is that a lot of these things are going to get totally sidetracked because all the space is being hogged by these three farm laws only. Yeah.
Hmm. Anita, do you want to comment or?
No, thank you. I understand what you're saying. I think that the yes. issue is much deeper.
Yeah.
I definitely agree with Kavita that there's much more that we have to talk about feudalism, casteism, patriarchy in farming and agrarian society itself has got its own issues.
Yeah.
How we treat each other. At the same time, there seems to be a larger discourse of seeing small farmers as basically unviable. And a lot of the thinking comes from this assumption that small holdings are not viable. And therefore the callousness of, you know, anyway, they can't survive in today's world. So this thing, seeing the small farmer who is 80% of our farmers as somebody who's unviable and therefore need not be supported is to me a very core understanding of how we look at farming today. And this is what Nandan also talked about a little earlier, that we do not want to see them as people who have to be helped to become viable. Rather, we would just accept that they're unviable and push them out.
In farmers' cooperatives, you know, this is one beautiful way of going ahead. And how this entire cooperative movement have been scuttled by all successive governments. Because once the farmers get together, they start feeling threatened because then they can demand. Then they can get together and form a body and a platform and say, this is what we want. This is what we want to do. This is what no government wants, the farmers cooperative way. They can become self-sustainable if the farmers can come together as cooperatives. That's another very powerful issue that needs to be addressed in the agriculture sector. And Shweta, you have written that what can we do? There are lots of problems around. There is no doubt about it. You can start from wherever you want to start. For instance, we say that as filmmakers, we have made these films. If you feel encouraged, if you feel yes, start disseminating work, not only our work. There is so much that you can simply, by the click of your mouse, you can start disseminating. You can start writing. There are so many NGOs, there are so many farmers cooperatives that we recently discovered, say, in a city like Nasik. From there, a farmers cooperative brings their fresh produce to us each weekend. And this is how we got to know about how they work. You can start small groups of citizens. You can start educating children. You can do so much. The point is, we don't have to go and plant our flag on the Mount Everest. We have to become like small, you know, take even our baby steps count a lot. People often ask us, you make such films, do you think they'll make a difference? Do you think it matters to somebody? I say, when I go to colleges and college students come to me and say, we didn't know this was happening in our country. Thank you. You have made me more aware. I said, my work is done. This is how. Just choose your own journey and I'm sure you'll go a long way.
Yeah. I'll add to what Kavita was saying. So this farmers cooperative who brings us the food, even in the lockdown, they were like super diligent and they somehow managed to give, you know, totally organic, untouched by any pesticide, any fertilizer, and wonderful food. and same price as the pesticide laden junk that we were getting earlier. And we thought that, my God, Mumbaikers eat such trash. So when we got them involved and we invited them to come to our residential complex and deliver, we live in a very, you know, something which is far away from the mainland Mumbai. So they said, okay, we'll come. But do you have a group? We said, no, we don't have a group, but we'll form a group. We'll get more people interested. Slowly, we built up a community, me and Kavita. And today we are 140 people strong. And then last 2 months, we've started something called Adopt a Farmer, where we are trying to handhold the farmers because they don't have access to rural banking. That's gone. They don't want to chase money lenders. Banks don't give them money because they don't have collaterals. So we said, okay, as a community, we are dependent upon you. You are feeding us. You are our annadatas. What can we do in return? So they said that we have some very basic issues, and each farmer, some of our farmers are really poor. Each farmer needs something like 30,000-35,000 rupees every season as help, sometimes to buy seeds, sometimes to augment his irrigation facility or something, sometimes to dig a pond. Can people like you sort of do something? We said, as a community, let us start contributing. So 1,10,000 rupees in the last 15 days, Kavita has...
As advance payment. They didn't take it as a loan.
Correct. Correct. It's not a dole. Yeah, it's not a loan. It's just paying it forward. Paying it forward is such a beautiful, yeah, you know, human thing. If we understand that our food security is dependent upon these farmers, can't we as educationists, as filmmakers, as students, as lawyers, as doctors, whatever, we have to eat twice a day. And some people eat thrice a day for some reason. So that those two meals and the first meal of breakfast of fruits has to come from these farmers, no? We can't live on lab-produced capsules. We can't. So, bhaiya, inka dhyan rakhna important hai na? We have to take care of our farmers. We have to do something, go beyond the calling of what our professions are. We are so, you know, comfortable. Kitty, I'm a doctor. I'm a lawyer. This is my job. I'll get the money home, raise my children. That's my job. No, no, no. You've got to take care of your farmers. You've got to take care of your... Are there ponds existing in your vicinity, in your village, in your city? No, they're not. The rainwater is all going out, going into the drain. So our country is going to face a severe water crisis very soon. We are actually staring at it. Sorry, Kavita is telling me that I'm digressing.
No, no, you're not digressing. I think Amudan would like to say something.
Yeah.
Amudan?
But Anita had raised a very important question. In short, Amudan, just a moment. Anita, I agree with you that the situation at the macro level has been designed to go bad. And these people who sit in governance in our country and abroad, they are part of a very, very global system which is undermining the people, undermining the people's interests, to foist upon us governance systems which are progressively going towards the right, progressively feeding the entrenched interests like our corporations, whether in India or abroad, global corporations, very big corporations, very big money is involved. And anybody who stands opposed to their systems and their policies is slowly sort of targeted. Beshak Elgar Parishad mein aap kuch kijiye, beshak aap kahin pe kijiye. You raise your voice, say that I stand with my farmers and I'm opposed to you, Mr. Modi. They'll come and pick you up that you're a left-wing urban naxal. So this is what is happening. It's a proper systematic approach. They are trying to obliterate all trace of civilized behavior and humanistic thinking. And it's a game plan. This is not something which is happening piecemeal. This is happening something on a global level. And as citizens, if we don't fight back and lend our voice to what the farmers are doing, or what the young, the labor is doing, and the workers who walked thousands of kilometers to their homes in the pandemic. My God, this is an amazing, you know, situation. The spectacle was so heartbreaking. So we are 100% with you when you say that there is a macro failure. This is a systemic failure. And it's something which has been orchestrated. This is not something which is sort of just happening. Okay. Yeah, Muthan.
Thank you. So I'm just, I'd like to invite others to Sweta. We have Ishan.
Namaste, ma'am. And so it was very interesting to see your films. And there's something very interesting. For example, I was very interested in watching Candles in the Wind and the issues of women that you have picked up. And I thought, how could you have stopped? Like, for example, their narratives, beginning from Karamjit's narrative towards the end, be it Surjit Kaur and everything. It must have been very challenging. And I really want to also understand, like, how do you made an attempt to stop yourself? Because the last part discussing about the chemical farming and the death coming there. Very big issue in Punjab, something, as I stay in Chandigarh, we don't even think of, because what's happening in Punjab is, there's, as we all know, a cancer express, quote unquote, is running. And you picked up that very pertinent issue also. Traces of very other interesting issues also, for example, the Chadar tradition. That was very interesting, because I thought if we are discussing about farmers and Chadar tradition is a very interesting aspect when we're discussing about, especially in Punjab, because and other things also. So I thought that seeing one film was almost like seeing four or five films together, because there's just not one aspect. There's just not farming there. There was the core issues of women. And I think, again, as you have rightly pointed out, we're discussing about farm issues these days. The issues related to women, I think, is something that we don't even start to think of. For example, in the current protest also, we are discussing about MSPs, we are discussing about other things also, and women are participating. But what about the issues of women? For example, all these people have died, and the farmers have died, and they're taking on the burden and coming again from next to Punjab. And women are sharing lots of responsibilities. So that was something very interesting, Candles in the Wind. And there's a song that I really enjoyed in this thing where Karamjit sings, Likhiyan Lekh Diyan, Pogla Le Manachit Laake Ni Likhiyan Lekh Diyan. That was like, as a person, I am in my bubble, thinking about my struggles, a kind of a privileged position. And there's this woman who is fighting situation and is taking life head on. That was something very interesting. And as filmmakers, understanding your dilemmas and your problems was something very interesting. For example, I've seen this film a couple of times. It always gives me on a thinking plane, like, how do you deal with such issues? So yes, thank you for all these things. Thank you Visham.
We have a few friends whose names are very interesting. There's a friend called AY. I don't know the person's, I'm not able to identify the person's name. Do you want to comment or have questions? AY. Okay. We have another friend whose name is The Fame. Can I invite Miss or Mr. The Fame? Okay. Yes. Okay. Then
tell Kavita and Nandan, I've typed a message, I'll send it. But apart from running Samvada, where we also run farmers field schools and help young farmers deal with their issues, I also teach at Azim Prem University, and I'll be teaching a course called Women and Work. And one of the discussions that we are constantly having is about the undercounting of women's work in agriculture. So this whole debate around the diminishing female labor force participation doesn't count women from small and marginal farmer households who are actually contributing to their homesteads. And they themselves say that, you know, we are looking after the buffaloes, etc. They see it as part of the family's
work and not necessarily in economic activity. So this whole idea of undercounting of women's work in when they work on their own farms or when they work in exchange of labor with their neighbors' farms is something that we will be talking about. I definitely would love to show your films to my students, and I will be
thank you
all in the months to come. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Anita.
Thank you, Anita. So, I think we have covered everybody. If anybody has any comments, questions. Vijayashanti, do you have any questions? Do you want to feel, you have to reflect on discussion that we had?
Oh, sir, I think it was very in detail. I like the discussions and how they have, you know, shared a lot about the process of making and things like that. Thank you so much for the film. Thank you.
Vijay, I just want to add one small thing here because you had mentioned it. And that is that you said we have been taught to keep ourselves away from the narratives, our personal narratives from the films. Mm-hmm. Am I right? I'm just
mostly we are taught to do that way, right? But yeah.
So I just want to say here that what my experience is, and this is really personal,
mm-hmm.
is that you can tell the story most truthfully when it comes from your own heart.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't invest a part of your own self into your film, it cannot be an honest storytelling. Mm-hmm. This is what I feel. We also started the same way, keeping ourselves away from our films, but we weren't enjoying them. We were using very polished voices for voiceovers, the best voiceover people in the country. But then it was not working. When we started watching films from other countries, films that talked to us, and we became very impressed by those films, we understood the filmmakers had the courage to identify themselves with the subject and also use their own voices, not because they lacked resources. Like in the case of Indian filmmakers, we have no support for our documentaries, but because they wanted to place themselves into their films through their voices or through their presence. And our films have traveled a lot. And the feedback that we have got from our audiences that we like your films best when you are there in it, because we feel that vicariously we are being represented in the film. So don't be afraid. There are no rules here. You make your films the way you want to make, because ultimately they'll be called your films. This is what I want to say.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that response, because of late that's also the thought that I've been having. So how do you like do it? Because that's something that is attacked more often than not for especially for a documentary film, right?
Yeah, so, especially for a documentary.
Yeah. So I think that gives us more hope and courage to take up certain things on those lines. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm glad. Thank you.
Yes. I think we have Pushpa just joined now. Pushpa, do you have comments, questions, quickly?
Sorry I'm late, very late actually. But Happy New Year, everybody, first of all. And thank you so much. I think watching this was overdue. Right. So, and it's also important, I think, I was hearing what Vijayashanti was saying, that, when you have voiceovers, I think, you know, somewhere something is lost, because that may be a very generic thing, or the context for that, the voice or the lines, the text you've extracted from somebody else's was perhaps meant for another situation. So as you said, you know, it's so important that way. Like I have done a lot of work on journalism and writing and maybe, you know, taking stills and stuff. And like people trust you when, you know, you become with them. Travel with them, like, you know, metaphorically or physically. So I think that's an important thing. And obviously, you know, the women of Punjab, sorry, the candles in the wind were, this women of Punjab is the password, but then, you know, I thought that was a very apt thing, very coincidentally struck me. That because sometimes their stories and their realities are often not known. You know, suicides are tragic. Okay, we've written about the lesser known silk farmer suicides which happened in Ramnagara and Karnataka. Okay, and I've been on both sides of the Kaveri struggle, you know, grew up in Chennai and then been in Bangalore. And, you know, the, so obviously the sugar farmers and all were being affected. But the always the people who survive and who have to bear the burden, you know, their stories are rarely said. And often it's the women because, you know, the everything is literally snatched away from them. And they have so many people to take care of, so much to handle, apart from debts and everything often. So I think that that's an important thing that you have said. And so much so for us in the South, you know, we don't, I mean, we've always seen until perhaps till the farmers are protesting, we always think or read that Punjab is a, of course it is a fertile state, but there are only wealthy farmers there. People may not commit suicide there. You know, we think it's only for the dry lands of Telangana, Maharashtra, and some parts of North Karnataka and all that. But so that is why also, it's not just about being poignant, it's the harsh reality. So thanks for that. And, you know, I will, yeah. And just one more thing, do I have time? Just one thing I just
yes, yes, yes,
go ahead. Okay. Yeah, yeah. So other thing is, you know, the BT thing, the BT cotton, right from the title, I don't know how you chose that title because, you know, being a writer and a person who's reviewed many films, I don't believe in critiquing. I just like to kind of say, I just wanted to know how you, you know, chose titles because apart from technical, other technicalities, I always want to know how, you know, the titles are chosen. So I just wanted to know the candles in the wind and cotton for my shroud. Well, maybe a small thing, but yeah.
I can speak of candles. Cotton was Nandan's idea. It's like an epiphany, you know.
Right.
It just strikes you. I remember I was just sitting in the house we stayed earlier. There was a small kitchen garden. So I was just sitting by its side looking at the plants and you know, film is, I always say, a film is like a baby. Hmm. It grows within you. And so I was thinking of something and suddenly it like candles in the wind. It just came to me.
Okay.
And I said, Nandan, we found the title, I think. So I think, Nandan, what happened with Cotton for My Shroud?
With Cotton for My Shroud, see, we were very sure that we are not trying to sort of... it should not be our perspective, though we are the two people who are going and sort of exploring. It was also an inward journey. But the title says Cotton for My Shroud. So this my is a very telling thing because this is the farmer who's growing the cotton for his own shroud. And when we understood the scale of the genocide and we understood that, okay, it is something which is beyond the ken of mere mortals to understand and how we have been blind to it for so long. It was traumatic for us to even go and film there. And when we came to the editing studio, because I edited the film myself, 300 times if you have to watch the same things, it's like... It's crazy. It drives you totally crazy. And then we were very sure that, no, this has to both be direct and poetic because in pain is poetry. So.
Yes, I think the best creations sometimes emerge from the greatest pain, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Yeah, and yeah, so that I think is, you know, a very honest approach to the whole thing. You get involved, obviously you get emotionally stirred and so nice of you to share all that because it is very tough. You know, I mean, in Karnataka, Jairam Ramesh and others host, we had this public hearing on BT Brinjal.
Yeah.
But Yeah, and I mean, I don't know if this may be a cliched question, but when you screen the film for the people whom you filmed, or presumably you did that, and how did they respond? I mean, you know, so.
Actually, it's a very interesting experience because when we screen with the people whom we have filmed for, they cannot believe it. And sometimes, you know, it is such a moving thing. Like, this is a trilogy. The Farmer films are a trilogy. Mm. You've seen the first two. And the third one is set at Niyamgiri. Ah, and it tells the story of the Aboriginal farmers there who sort of are on the slopes of the Niyamgiri.
Right. I visited, you know, Niyamgiri, so yeah.
Yeah. Mm. So there, we didn't speak their language. They didn't understand us.
Right.
So the question of representation was a very delicate question here. And how do you place your camera? And you can't direct. Mm. So you are truly bearing witness to what is unfolding and truly dependent on the grace of God. And there are epiphany, moments of epiphany there.
Mm.
And there, what happened was the film is called I Cannot Give You My Forest. Again, the same way like in the cotton film, Cotton for My Shroud, there the women are saying, I cannot give you my forest. So they own the forest. Like it's a total ownership that this is my forest and I cannot give you. So it's a very beautiful story. Again, this time there was no voiceover at all, not even the two of us leading the viewers in. It was totally them center stage, only that Kavita and my colleagues in our team, they have a small cameo towards the end where the women tie wo jo bell ke gale mein ghanti hoti hai na, the cowbell. They tie a cowbell around the neck of our sound recordist. So towards the end, and they give a lot of their farm produce to Kavita, who opens out her dupatta like this, and they keep putting, and it is full, and she can't hold any further. And she says, "Mera to aanchal bhar gaya, and you've given so much." So it's a very poetic, very poignant moment in the film. After the film is over, before the credits, this happens.
Mm.
Okay. So that is the only point where, like Alfred Hitchcock, or where Kavita makes an appearance in our film. Now, when the film was made and we screened it in the Niyamgiri for the Adivasis, it was so interesting how they took ownership, because they said that these Agya log, Agya is like sirs and ma'ams basically, these people who have come, it's an honorific title basically. So Agya log itna acche se hum log ki philosophy samjhe, hum log ka jeevan samjhe, aur hum log ka dard samjhe. So they said, these people have understood what is our philosophy as an Aboriginal people, what is our philosophy of life and of agriculture, of our food systems. They understood our predicament and they also understood our pain and how poetically they have presented. They said, this is the first time we have been represented so truthfully, because the news and other people who come and take pictures and go away, they do their own stories, boss. They push their own agendas. And these were people who have actually never faced cameras at such close proximity over a protracted period of 5 years that we took to make the film. And then they screened the film on their own. They took DVDs and they screened the film on their own, village by village by village. And they formed committees that if these people have found our food systems and our practices so interesting, so as to document it so well and so properly, there must be intrinsic value which we do not want to lose. And we want to propagate this. We want to hand it over to the next generation in our oral tradition. So let us work more to keep our roots alive. Let us water our roots some more. And the young generation should know what our traditions and what our practices and our philosophy is. So we were so overwhelmed okay, amazing. So we've had such beautiful experiences with our people.
Lovely.
Yeah.
Okay, on that note, I think we can happily wind up the session. So we had a very, very in-depth, very personal, very intimate sharing. And thank you very much, all
thank
of you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amadan.
Thank you, Kavita.
For screening our films.
Thank you,
Nandan. Thank you.
Thank you,
everybody. Such a pleasure interacting with everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody, for joining on a Sunday.
Yes.
Happy New Year, as Puspa said.
Happy New Year.
To all. Hope we will survive this year also.
Yeah.
Don't worry. To zinda hai, to zindagi ki jeet pe
yakin kar.
Yeah, yakin karenge. Thank you, thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Also, bye. Bye.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
All of you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you too. Take care.